And we're here this evening with somebody that's been integral to the Military Business and Community Expo at Naval Base Ventura County, Mr. Bill Barato, who is the President and CEO of Vesita.
Hello, Bill.
Good evening. Good to be here.
And we're wondering, what is it that you have that you can tell us about this event and why it's important to you?
Well, we've done this for 4 years, and this event really is an opportunity to do a couple of things. Number one, celebrate Naval Base Ventura County and all that it does for our community. And two, to create and stimulate economic activity between private sector companies here in the county and the Naval Base. And so we've put these things, these expos together so that small businesses who may not have an opportunity or a contact inside Naval Base Ventura County have an opportunity to come out and talk to contracting people, technical people, so that they can establish relationships that then they can build on to create opportunities for contracts for local businesses.
Well, that really is what it's all about when we talk about this particular year's subject matter, isn't it? Because this year, more importantly, I think, than any other year in the past or perhaps any year in the future, we're talking about something that the Secretary of the Navy has mandated become the big great green fleet. And can you tell us a little bit about what's happening with that regard?
Sure. Secretary Mabus has mandated or ordered that the Navy reduce their carbon footprint and become more energy efficient. We want to help the Navy do that, and so we've invited the Assistant Secretary of the Navy for Installation, Energy, and Environment to tell us what the vision is for the Navy to move towards this new environmentally friendly green fleet.
Well, I think it's one of the things that has amazed me so much about what President Kennedy did in 1960s when he said we needed to put a man on the moon by the end of the decade. So Secretary of the Navy Ray Mabus has said we need to eliminate 50% of the carbon use of energy by all of our naval forces by the end of the decade, by 2020.
Absolutely.
So your show goes a long way. This expo goes a long way to introducing the young companies, the new technology companies.
That's right.
Companies that will help them do that. And
yes.
Tomorrow's expo is expected to be able to do that. Is that correct?
Absolutely. Absolutely. We have over 30 exhibitors coming tomorrow, and we expect over 400 people to be there, community business people, other people interested in what Naval Base Ventura County is doing. And we're really looking forward and excited about the event tomorrow.
Well, the Navy League is really honored and very, very pleased to be able to support this effort that's taking place, because the Sierra Space Expo, which was just held in Washington, D.C., is held each year, really is the maritime acquisition conference of the year in the world. And most recently, the Secretary of the Navy reiterated that, as did the VCNO Greenert, Vice Chief of Naval Operations, and a host of other leading military and DOD people. So what you're doing is extremely important, and this is the fourth expo of this kind in the Ventura County area.
Absolutely.
With Naval Base Ventura County, but it is the first in the world that I'm aware of that is really addressing the Great Green Fleet and the promotion of the needs of the Navy and the naval forces with the needs of the community and the capabilities of the community. So I applaud you, I applaud your organization, and we look forward to supporting you in every way we can. The Navy League's going to be here to help you do that.
Well, thank you very much, Doug. We couldn't do this without the support of the Santa Barbara Navy League. You guys have been here from the beginning, all 4 years. You have provided support and resources for us to be able to do this, and we're just appreciative of the relationship and partnership that we've got with the Santa Barbara Navy League. So thank you.
Well, I think it's very appropriate that the saying of the CBs here at Port Hueneme is can do. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Doug.
Take care.
Well, I have the privilege of introducing Rear Admiral Mark Heinrich. He's got over 6,400 people working for him, 200 locations. I've been told that he's an open water swimmer, and was up early this morning and swimming in the Pacific Ocean and didn't even put on a wetsuit. So if you were thinking of throwing spitballs or doing anything like that, I gotta tell you, he's not the guy you probably want to mess with. So without further ado, Rear Admiral Mark Heinrich.
Thank you.
I haven't had an introduction like that in quite a while. And it's true, I do swim, and I swim with a bunch of guys. They're all a bunch of knuckleheads. Most of them are SEALs or former SEALs, and it's true I don't wear a wetsuit. Because the joke we all make is you can wear a wetsuit if you want, but you have to have matching eyeliner. But now, I tell you, Patricia said I had to start with a joke because it's right after lunch. And Bill, before I tell a joke, because I'm still thinking of one, this is kind of this FedEx Walmart, almost not quite just in time speech. I was, as you may have noticed, I was writing it up there until I had a chance to wolf down my sandwich. But Bill, thanks to the Ventura County Economic Development Association, thanks to the Channel Islands and the Santa Barbara Navy League, certainly thanks to the base for all the logistics support and for everything you've done to make this day possible. This is, truly amazing. And when you talk about how, honestly, when it comes to energy, all politics are local. And what you learn over and over again is think big, start small, and then scale. And that's exactly what you're doing. And I can't wait to come back in a couple of years and see what this has become, because I suspect it's going to get bigger. And I do feel at home here. I am a Southern California native. I've got a son at UC Santa Barbara. And as much as I want to go see him, he really needs to concentrate in his studies. So I'm going to stay away and let him try to focus. And he's a senior. And, well, there's still hope. So we'll see. What's the line? I'm a freshman in my fourth year at UC Santa Barbara, and my goal is to be a veterinarian. Because I love children. He's going to be fine. He's fine in his way. And so now Patricia said I had to tell a joke. And, it's a new Navy. We're going through a lot of logical changes, a lot of training going on, but some things stay the same. So not too long ago, I was aboard a ship, and I walked by, and there was a sailor chip in paint. He was working on a torpedo tube, and he had his coveralls on, and you really couldn't see his name, and he was new to the ship. And the chief walked by and said, "Sailor, what's your name?" I said, "John, sir." The chief exploded. He said, "What kind of boot camp did you go to that you use your first name? It's Seaman Smith, Seaman Jones, not John. Now, sailor, what's your name?" Long pause, he says, "Sir, Seaman Darling. Seaman Darling, sir." So the chief thought for a second and said, "John, let me tell you what we're going to do." So some things, did I do okay? All right. How about that for, like I said, a not quite just in time remark? But, like I said, it's a privilege for me to be here to have a chance to talk to y'all. Energy, you heard Secretary Fanninsteel talk, and if you didn't detect her enthusiasm, it really is there. I had a chance to listen to some of the discussions earlier on, in between her speech and lunch. And one of the things that sort of came up periodically is we got a strategy, but sometimes culture and behaviors get in the way. And I will tell you that the goal of the secretary and the senior leadership, and one of the reasons I'm here today, is to reaffirm that our culture within the Navy is changing, that our commitment to energy conservation, our commitment to alternative energy, our commitment to the Secretary's energy goals is real, and it is absolutely very strong. And it's exciting for the Navy and for the nation, honestly, and that's why I'm here. It really is. So I'm going to build on the comments of the Secretary and just make it clear that the energy initiatives are at the forefront of the issues we're addressing at the national level and really throughout the Navy. And I'm a logistician, and so I'm going to talk about how we're providing the logistics support to the Secretary's goals. And I'll kind of hone in on the alternative energy piece specifically. Now the Secretary said that the Great Green Fleet would be akin to Theodore Roosevelt's initiative of 100 years ago, when the Great White Fleet demonstrated that the United States was a world sea power. And it really also provided an opportunity for us to improve the seaworthiness of our fleet, which was, at that point, it was still really an emerging Navy. But they visited many countries, and the great white fleet of the time became an icon of goodwill. And it's no secret that our goal here is to use the great green fleet to showcase our initiatives and our commitment to energy security and energy independence. So I'm going to focus on the tactical side of the business. You heard the Secretary talk about the tactical piece and the shore piece, and I'm going to focus on the tactical piece, which is really going to highlight our initiatives to acquire new replacements for petroleum-derived fuel. Our petroleum supplies have always been a critical warfighting capability. In the old days, people talked about beans, bullets, and black oil. That's how we supported our fleet. Provisions, fuel, and ammunition is what it took to make a ship of the line effective in battle. I'm a global logistician, and I have a worldwide network of logistics providers. If you put the petroleum piece in perspective, we have almost 1,200 fuel tanks around the world that support our warfighting capability. 1,200 fuel tanks, that ranges in size from small tanks in the 30,000 gallon range to 20 large tanks that carry almost 13 million gallons of fuel each, tunneled out of a mountain in Hawaii. Now, a lot of guys don't even know they're there, but has anybody ever heard of Red Hill? Red Hill is 20 fuel tanks, 250 feet tall, 125 feet wide, 5 miles uphill from the naval base, underground. And they were started in the late 30s, before the war, and they were completed in the early 40s, and they were done in secret. They were done in secret. And that was because we knew that our fuel supplies were critical to the success of the Pacific Fleet, but they were susceptible to enemy aerial attack. So they built these 20 underground tanks, each of them 250 feet tall, drilled out of solid rock, each with a capacity of almost 13 million gallons. Now, that's not even our largest tanks. The largest tank that we have is near Sasebo, Japan, in Irizaki, and it carries 17.7 million gallons of jet fuel. Truly 10% of our worldwide petroleum reserves are actually stored in Japan, in the Western Pacific. That tells you how critical energy security is to our warfighting capability and why petroleum is a worldwide capability. Now, to maintain these facilities, I'll be honest, I'm a regular customer of Paz Gomez and her NFEST team and Mike Roca over at SCAN. And just to put it in perspective, my SRM budget for these fuel tanks is larger than the entire SRM budget for the United States Navy. I'm over $300 million in SRM. And my MILCON program is over $100 million right now, including a $195 million fuel farm that we're putting in Point Loma, and a $78 million fuel pier that we're putting in Point Loma. So energy is big business. Our annual labor costs are upwards of $30 million, and it is a significant chunk of money we spend in ensuring our ability to operate our fleet and ensure it's a global Navy. So you think we're dependent on petroleum? Absolutely. And it's a recognized vulnerability. Global demand continues to rise, increased consumption in South America, Africa, the Middle East. Last year, the department spent $15 billion on procuring petroleum. Now, that's for the Department of Defense. We spent $300 million just on tankering it around. $300 million just paying for fuel tankers. Now, for those of you like gee whiz numbers, that's 5.5 billion gallons for the Department of Defense and 1.34 billion gallons for the Navy. So we're always going to be around, and logistics is always going to be in demand, And frankly, where's the Navy going to be? We're going to be supporting maritime security as population centers along the coast, just like here in the Ventura County area, continue to see increases in population and increases in petroleum demand. So that's our goal. The challenges of increased demand around the world are going to create these socioeconomic environmental pressures, and then you add in things like Libya, and pretty soon you've got $111 a gallon, $111 a barrel. So it's a real reality that we've got to adapt, and that's exactly why we're focused on what we're focused on, alternative energy. Now, you know, I'm a Californian, but I'm a Navy guy, and honestly, the two go hand in hand, because California's calling cards have always been innovation and environmental protection. It is important to recognize the whole reason that we talk about the environment and trying to reduce our dependence on energy is to ensure our ability to operate and train in a manner that allows us to protect the nation, provide for the national defense. That's the whole reason we do what we do. And in fact, I worked on a previous Assistant Secretary of the Navy for Insulation and Environment staff, and I cut my teeth doing pollution prevention and compliance. So this is not something I'm unfamiliar with. With all that as background, we're really focused on the Great Green Fleet. And you even heard the Secretary talk about the Macon Island. Now, the Macon Island with her hydroelectric drive, kind of a Prius-like effort that the electric drive that she has enables her to have efficient operations up to 12 knots. And when the Macon Island circumnavigated the South American continent coming from Pascagoula, her builder's yard out of San Diego, you know, she saved 1 million gallons of fuel. I think it's fitting that today, at this very moment, Macon Island is the backdrop of the Commander Third Fleet change of command. She's clearly demonstrating a technology that we're going to adapt to other ships, the Arleigh Burke class ships that are back on the builder's ways, and are going to adapt that electric drive. Now, these fuel savings are, you know, I'd said 1 million gallons, but what we're really talking about is saving 10%. 10%, and I gave you some gee whiz numbers, so when you start talking 10% of 5 billion or 10% of 1.3 billion gallons, that's a lot of fuel. So we're working on that, and you heard the Secretary talk about some of the research that's ongoing into energy storage and efficient power management afloat, lighting and the like, and all of that goes into reducing our dependence on petroleum. But in the end, it's really about alternative energy. One other comment, just because I can reflect on my days aboard USS Constellation in 1999. We were just deployed when the North Koreans launched that first Taepodong missile, and the National Command Authority told us to make top speed across the Pacific just to let the Koreans know that we noticed, but they did it. But during that flank speed transit, we calculated that on that USS Constellation, conventionally powered aircraft carrier, we burned 264 gallons of diesel fuel a second. That's why we have nuclear-powered aircraft carriers now. But that's a data point. And so just to roll all that up, you know, that's why we do what we do. So the Navy's no stranger to this business to reduce energy consumption, find green technologies. We created Task Force Energy. Task Force Energy was an official charter from the Chief of Naval Operations to try to have a new approach to energy management and try to really create energy awareness, back to that culture thing, and to change the culture. Because you can build all the strategies you want, but if you're not careful, culture will eat strategy for lunch. So make no mistake, the whole reason I'm here, the reason the Secretary is here, the reason these symposiums are so important is little by little we're changing the Navy's culture. And the Navy is focused on energy consumption. You can take a young guy, I was just talking to a young CB, waiting for A school, Cody, coming from Texas. Make no mistake, give Cody a couple of days, a couple of weeks, Cody's a believer. And every member of the team, civilian, military, and contractor alike, is going to be a believer because we are steady and synchronized on our message, and our messages are always aligned. It really is. And in fact, how are we going to do it? We're gonna sail. We're gonna demonstrate the Great Green Fleet in 2012, and then we're gonna really deploy it in 2016. So how are we gonna do that? It's a great question. You know, I'm a logistician. Alexander the Great had a very famous admonition. He said, "My logisticians are a humorless lot, because they know if I fail in battle, they'll be the first ones I slay." So, the slay thing has me a little worried, honestly. but I'm one of about 100 naval officers, actually supply officers in the Navy, that actually studied petroleum logistics at the University of Kansas in a specialized grad school program. You tie that petroleum education with the can-do culture that really represents the Navy, the Supply Corps, the CEC. What we do is we don't fail. We get things done. And that's how why I'm absolutely confident that we're going to deliver support to the Secretary's goals. So how are we going to do it? Here's some details. In 2012, this is going to require us to purchase 100,000 gallons of hydro-treated jet fuel and 350,000 gallons of hydro-treated marine diesel fuel. Now, these fuels are going to be blended with 50-50. Remember, we do a 50-50 blend. So we're going to blend those equally with regular petroleum-based jet fuel and petroleum-based diesel fuel. And then we're going to store them and deliver them. Now, 2016, requires a higher volume. What we've decided that volume is 40,000 barrels of each type of fuel is what we're planning to buy. So we're going to go from 100,000 barrels in 2012 of hydro-treated jet and 350,000 barrels of hydro-treated marine diesel fuel to 40,000 barrels of each. Remember what I said, think big, start small, and then scale. And Lord knows that's a pretty significant scale. So remember, that's 1.68 million gallons each. But you have to compare that, it's 3.4 million gallons total, but you have to compare that against what I said we used last year, which is 1.34 billion gallons for the Navy. So it's just a drop in a bucket, but it's an important start. Think big, start small, and scale. So now we've been producing hydro-treated jet and hydro-treated diesel for the last 2 years, first in very small quantities. And we paid about $400 a gallon. And that price is coming down. And I think by the time we buy these fuels in 2012, and we intend to make that purchase either just before or on the first day of the fiscal year, because remember, it's all about an annual budget. You know, we think we'll be in the $60 a gallon range. That's where we're sort of guessing we're going to be. And in fact, I'll have another comment about that in a second. Let me talk first about the test and certification process. You saw Secretary Fantasio put it up on the wall, and it was a very deliberate test criteria, starting with the Riverine craft, starting with the Super Hornet that flew a year ago now. We've got technical experts and chemists from NAVC, from NAVSUP, from NAVAIR, that are all working together to ensure that we've satisfied everybody's concerns. Aviation, ship, logistics, all the research and operational communities have come together in Task Force Energy to make sure that we can deliver the product the fleet needs where they need it and when they need it. We've developed a procurement specification both for algae and for the biomass component of the fuel. As you heard from the Secretary, it has to be a drop-in replacement. That's key. And it's got to perform like our traditional jet fuels, pour point, copper, lead, you name it, flash point. It's got to be able to meet all the criteria, all the chemical components that we test normal fuel to. we made a decision early on that we weren't going to change our infrastructure and we weren't going to change our equipment. And in the Department of Defense, we deal with a fungible product, as you can imagine. And so we've got to be able to blend fuel in very large fuel tanks. I talked about the size of the tanks we have in Hawaii and Japan. We're building very large tanks, 200,000 barrels per tank in San Diego right now in Point Loma. And we keep our tanks for a long time, by the way. When we just tore down a fuel tank in Point Loma, built in 1917. So we've had a fuel farm in Point Loma for 100 years. But with great support from Congress, great support from NAVFAC, great support from Defense Logistics Agency, we're putting a fuel farm that'll last another 100 years there. So we're going to be in the petroleum business for a very long time. But what I want you to take away from the qualification process is two words, systematic and thorough. Those two words characterize the hard work that's going on to make sure that this fuel is working. We're testing these 50-50 blends of these hydrotreated petroleum and alternative renewable fuels. And we're following DOD contracting procedures as well. But the Task Force Energy team's developed these specifications, and we're interested in hearing from all comers as far as suppliers go. Solazyme obviously is a big partner with us right now, but the key we decided early on is we said we didn't want the renewable sources of fuel to compete with food stocks. So corn and soy were out. That's one decision we made. So for the Navy's use, camelina-based fuels are what we bought. It's a mustard seed plant, and it's very close structurally to petroleum than a lot of other bio-based plants. It's pretty darn close. And from a sustainability point of view, camelina doesn't need a lot of water. So we don't want to displace croplands that might otherwise be used to grow subsistence crops. The algae-based product that we're producing, that's the diesel fuel product that we're producing. And of course, again, with algae, it's a potential contender because you can get, with algae, you can get 10 times the oil per acre that you can get with a corn or a soy-based plant. So that's why, and by the way, the diesel fuel we're using for ships is a lot different than the diesel fuel you would buy for over-the-road production. I mean, our ships go pretty far north, like Arctic Circle north, and so we have things called freeze point. We really worry about things like that. The last thing you want is a ship to end up, you know, up in the cold north or perhaps down by Antarctica and have freeze point problems with its fuel. That would be bad.